Good morning, everyone. Thanks so much for joining us for our healthy eating webinar. We're very excited to have you with us today and hope you're all doing well. My name is Beth. I'm the Director of Healthy Living for the YMCA of Greater Toledo, and I'm really excited about the resources we're going to hear about today, but also some resources that are available on our ymcatoledo.org website. So make sure you're checking there often. We do have a virtual workout hub there with lots of information for you if you're looking for ways to stay active during this time. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce Divya. Divya Agarwal is a registered and licensed dietitian. She received her Bachelor of Science in Nutrition from Case Western Reserve University and her Master of Science in Human Nutrition from Columbia University. She completed her training in dietetics at Cornell University and has been a health and wellness coach with Gem Care Wellness, a partner of ours, for 3 years and believes everyone has the power to achieve optimal health. We will be sending out a follow-up email to all participants with links as well as 3 follow-up documents on weight loss and nutrients to boost the immune system, so keep an eye out for those. Divya, the stage is yours.
All right. Thank you, Beth, and hello, everyone. My name is Divya Agarwal, and I am a licensed and registered dietitian with Gem Care Wellness. We are thrilled to be partnering with the YMCA of Greater Toledo to bring you this live nutrition webinar this morning. Our Gem Care dietitians are also available to assist Y members with any nutrition or fitness questions you may have. You can send your general nutrition and fitness questions to askbrd@ymcatoledo.org. For our session today, please feel free to ask questions throughout the talk, and we'll try to get to a few of those questions at the end of the presentation. There's a chat box, I believe, on the side here, so feel free to drop those comments and questions there. But with that said, let's dive right into our webinar. In this talk today, I will be discussing topics related to weight management and immune-boosting nutrition. So as a registered dietitian, weight management, as you can imagine, is a topic we counsel on quite a bit with patients and clients. My personal approach to counseling on weight management is to go back to basics. And by that, I mean balanced meals, proper portion sizes and portion control, as well as some component of physical activity. I like to explain how to build balanced meals via the MyPlate method. So I have my dinner plate here. Hopefully you guys can see this. So my plate says to make half of your plate fruits and or vegetables. I'm going to do that right here. Hopefully you can see that. We're going to make half. That's going to be about this much, okay, for our veg. There we go. All right. So half of our plate should be vegetables. So this is could be something like broccoli or a salad maybe with some leafy greens. And next we want to have a quarter of our plate to be protein. So I'm going to take my red marker here and we've got a quarter of our plate. So roughly around there. Here's where we're going to want some sorts of lean protein. Okay. So this could be lean meats, it could be chicken breast, seafood like salmon, for example. If you're looking for plant-based protein, your options might include beans or lentils or a soy product, perhaps. And then finally, our last quarter here is reserved for our whole grains, okay? So whole grains in this last quadrant here. And this might be where you might wanna have your brown rice or your whole grain pasta, maybe a small piece of whole grain bread, to name a few examples. Okay, so building balanced meals is very important. Spaghetti and meatballs and steak and potatoes are actually an incomplete meal without some vegetables on your plate as well. So building balanced meals like this is actually also a very helpful tool for weight management. It can be a very powerful portion control strategy as well. By filling up a majority of your plate with vegetables and lean protein options, your meal becomes more nutrient dense and less calorie dense. And vegetables and protein are also more satiating, they're more filling, and you can have a lot less of it and feel more full more quickly. I also wanted to share a few of my other favorite portion control strategies. I've received some very positive feedback on how successful and helpful these particular tips are. First is to drink a glass or two of water right before you have your meal. Water has no calories, but it does have volume. Thus, that glass or two of water can help you fill your stomach just a little bit before the meal and help you feel full faster. My next tip is to use smaller plates. The studies have shown that people are actually programmed to want to fill the empty spaces on a plate with food, whether they're actually hungry for that much food or not. And so this process of trying to fill up the plate can actually result in some overeating. Thus, I recommend switching to some smaller plates. You might find that you are actually satisfied with much less food. Finally, I hear a lot about how portion control can be particularly difficult with snacks. My recommendation here is to not eat from the snack container itself. It's best to portion out the snack from the bag or the box, maybe a bowl or a plate or another small little baggie, and it will be easier to limit yourself to that serving that way. This is actually a perfect lead into our next topic regarding proper portion sizes. And I just want to run through what one serving will look like for some of the four common food groups. So for a piece of fruit, one serving, if you can visualize this, one medium piece of fruit is the size of a baseball. Okay, that's one medium piece of fruit. For vegetables, a half cup cooked vegetables, raw vegetables, will be the size of a light bulb. And one cup leafy greens is that baseball once again. For grains, a slice of bread would be the size of a CD case. That's what we consider one serving of whole grains. And one cup dry cereal is, again, that baseball presentation there. And a half cup of cooked rice, pasta, or cereal is the size of a light bulb. For your proteins, 3 ounces of chicken or meat would be the size of a deck of cards. If you're looking for fish, that would be the size of a checkbook. 3 ounces of fish is the size of a checkbook. 2 tablespoons of protein from peanut butter is a ping pong ball, would be the size of a ping pong ball. And if you're looking for dairy, a cup of yogurt would be, again, that size of that baseball. And pieces of cheese, 1.5 ounces of cheese, it would be considered the size of about 4 dice. So that's just a quick run through of portion sizes. And this, again, is what one serving of each of these items looks like. And we'll have all of these portion sizes for you in a handout. It will be part of the supplemental materials coming to you after this webinar. So don't worry if you missed that. We'll send you the handout for it. All right, so now while diet control plays a major role in weight loss, it is important to have a regimen of physical activity, and that also contributes to weight management, particularly in that it helps to maintain weight loss. Physical activity can also help with body toning and muscle building, and that helps to reduce excess body fat, and that's because muscle is fat-burning tissue. So I just wanted to share some simple ideas for cardio and strength training while at home. Again, for me, it's back to the basics. And first up is walking, especially if the weather is nice. It's just wonderful to get outside, get some fresh air. However, if the weather has some other ideas, you can just as easily get an effective workout at home with walking. If you have a flight of stairs, going up and down those a few times, this will actually help with toning your legs while getting some low impact aerobic cardio exercise. There are also some excellent guided indoor walking videos on sites like YouTube, and I encourage you to check those out as well. The classic cardio exercise is definitely jumping jacks. It's a great warm-up too. So before you get into your walking, before maybe you get into other aspects of your fitness or training regimen for that day, start it off with a set of jumping jacks to get you warmed up. The best exercise for building up and strengthening abdominal muscles, again, the classic crunches. When you're just getting started, don't worry if you are unable to get your head up all the way. So as long as you're just getting up a little bit and you're feeling the stretching of your muscles, you will see some benefit. Jogging in place. Jogging is a great exercise for your heart. And you can jog in place while at home, while watching TV or listening to music. And the only equipment you will need for this is a good pair of shoes. I also like leg lifts, and these are great for building up strength and muscles in your legs. And essentially what you do with leg lifts is, you probably can't see this, but kind of going up and down on your tippy toes, and you're gonna feel a little bit of stretch in your calves. So that's really good for toning those calves. And you can do leg lifts pretty much anywhere in your house. So it's good to get a set of those in throughout the day, and you're building up strength and muscles in your legs. We have squats, of course, another great exercise for your legs. And even if you're only able to do just a few repetitions of squats, you will still be providing some benefit to your body. So another helpful exercise. Then there's some light weightlifting. And no, you don't need to have a set of gym weights or dumbbells for this. Now, more than ever, is the time to be resourceful. So you can start out with something lighter, such as a jar of pasta sauce. You can then work your way up to maybe some heavier items here. So this is about maybe a pound, so a jar of pasta sauce here. But then you can maybe use something like here. I got this big milk jug. This is a gallon milk jug, probably of 8 to 10 pounds, depending on how much water you have in here. So this can be a good weight. If you want to start lower, you have a half gallon, could be about 5 pounds. An alternative to this would be a laundry detergent bottle or even water jug. So believe it or not, you can get a great workout from these items. And you can do almost all, if not all, exercises that you would do with a normal set of weights or dumbbells. Finally, and this is my personal favorite, dancing is a wonderful exercise. It's great for your heart. And not only is it a fantastic source of cardio, but it can really lift your spirits as well. So I would love to hear how you guys are keeping active these days and how you might be being creative and resourceful yourselves when it comes to physical fitness at home. And so feel free to share your home fitness ideas in the chat with us. I think that'd be really cool to see. Okay. So, but now I'd like to move on to an ever-relevant topic, and that is immunity. And more specifically, I'd like to share some of the nutrients that are implicated in helping to boost immunity and some of the best food sources for these nutrients. And to do that, I'm going to bring in my immune boosting basket. I hope you guys can see this, all my healthy goodies here. We're gonna go through all of these. First, I'd like to talk about vitamin A. So vitamin A is our first immune boosting nutrient that I'd like to discuss. Vitamin A helps to regulate the immune system and protect against infections by keeping the skin, mouth, stomach, intestines, and respiratory tissues healthy. We find vitamin A in orange, yellow, and red color fruits and vegetables. So we got for example, we have our carrots here. I opted for the baby carrot variety here, if you can see that. And then red bell peppers. This is also a great source of vitamin A. One of my favorites, sweet potatoes. I like to make baked sweet potato fries with these guys in the air fryer. And then we also have fortified breakfast cereals and milk. I don't have that with me here, but those are also a great source of vitamin A. Of course, eggs. Eggs are a great source of vitamin A as well. And some of our dark green leafy vegetables, and so we've got our spinach here, and broccoli are also very, very good sources of vitamin A, okay? So that's number one. Vitamin C, I'm sure folks have heard quite a bit about the benefits of vitamin C for immunity, in particular when it comes to cold. So while vitamin C won't cure your cold necessarily, there are studies that have shown that it can significantly decrease your symptoms and make the cold symptoms a little milder. Potentially, it can also reduce the length of the cold if you consume 1,000 milligrams or more. And of course, as a dietitian, we suggest to get your nutrition from food and then not supplements. So I'll show you some varieties of foods for vitamin C as well. But in particular, what vitamin C does is that it stimulates the formation of antibodies. And those antibodies are what are fighting foreign organisms in your body, thus supporting your immune system. So where can we find vitamin C? So commonly, we like to find vitamin C from citrus. That would be your oranges, your lemons, tangerines are also good options, grapefruit. It can also be found, most people don't know this, in strawberries. You can find vitamin C in strawberries. We mentioned that red bell pepper. So this red bell pepper also has a good source of vitamin C. Blueberries, and once again, a star player, broccoli, a very good source of vitamin C. So another one of our star antioxidant and immune boosting nutrients are vitamin E. Vitamin E has antioxidant properties, and it may also support immune function. We can find vitamin E in a variety of fortified cereals. Vitamin E is commonly found in almonds as well. Peanuts, hazelnuts. I also have some peanut butter here. It's a good source of vitamin E. We also can find vitamin E in oils, vegetable oils, in particular sunflower and soybean oil. There's also vitamin E in sunflower seeds as well. And once again, our green leafy vegetables are star players. Spinach and broccoli also happen to contain vitamin E. All right, so next on our list that I want to discuss today is zinc. So zinc is a mineral which is also involved in helping the immune system work properly. And it can also help heal wounds. We can find zinc in lean meats. We can find zinc in, again, our eggs, seafood, milk, whole grain products, beans, seeds, and nuts. And so zinc, as those items that I listed off, you might recall, were up above in some other of our sections, vitamin C, vitamin A also are in eggs. So this is another star player, is our eggs, which will come up again when we talk about protein. So finally, protein is vital in helping the body to heal and recover. And that also plays a beneficial role in the body's immune system. You can obtain protein, of course, from a variety of sources. Again, here comes the egg. Lean meats are also a good source of protein, seafood, plant-based protein sources, lentils, beans, soy products, nuts and seeds. Okay, so you might look back and see that, wow, she mentioned a lot of things a few times. And so these key players here, these staples, have a variety of these vitamins and nutrients. And that's why they're so powerful as immune-boosting foods, because they contain not one, but occasionally two, three, or four of some of the items that I shared with you today. So again, what we have here are some pretty simple ingredients. And so the recipes and meal ideas don't have to be complicated either. When suggesting immune-boosting meals and recipes to my clients, I definitely make sure to include some kind of smoothie, just because they're super easy to kind of make with a few ingredients and then take on the go with you. Particularly, I like to suggest those green smoothies, which would include a heaping serving of vitamin A, rich dark leafy greens such as spinach or kale, and then you could add some vitamins and minerals and protein from, say, a combination of either strawberries, blueberries, pineapples, again, nuts and seeds, and just blend it all up. Of course, there are a variety of other smoothie recipes on the internet, and you can make your own. Feel free to take some of these ingredients and experiment with your own smoothie ingredients as well. Another common but excellent immune-boosting recipe, in my opinion, is a veggie omelet. As I mentioned, this egg is considered a good source of protein and vitamin A and a variety of other minerals as well, not just for immune boosting. But then from there, we can add some nutrient-rich veggies, such as the spinach, this bell pepper, tomatoes, and that's going to make for a stellar immune-boosting breakfast. Of course, you really can't go wrong with salads. You know, adding dark leafy greens, beans, maybe some citrus fruit like orange and some strawberries. Throw in that egg, nuts, and maybe some seeds. I would say have fun with your salads. Make it colorful. More color usually means more nutrients, more vitamins, more minerals. It's easy to kind of assume that a salad just has to be a bed of lettuce with tomatoes and onions. No, a salad can be much, much more. You can add a variety of protein sources. A salad really can be a balanced and complete meal. Most of the aforementioned items can also work very, very well as snacks too. Citrus fruits, berries of a variety of berries, strawberries, blueberries can be eaten as a snack. Raw veggies, maybe with a hummus dip. Hummus is actually made from chickpeas, which is a lentil, and so a lentil beans. It's a very good source of calcium and other nutrients as well. And then, of course, almonds or peanut butter if you are interested in nuts, and hard-boiled egg is one of my favorite snacks for high protein and for immune boosting as well. Okay, so I did go through that pretty quickly, but I'm happy to take any questions anyone might have at this time about some of the stuff we've talked about from weight management and from an immune boosting perspective. We tried to make this talk very relevant for the times as well, to kind of coincide with maybe what people's lifestyles are like right now. So whether you want to ask general nutrition questions or look for other suggestions, ask for other suggestions about how to kind of stay healthy during this time, be happy to answer those here. Or of course, you know, please do send your questions to askthird@ymcatoledo.org. That's askthered@ymcatoledo.org. But if anybody has any questions at this time, I would love to answer those. So I'm going to take a look at our chat here and see what we've got. All right, so I'm here, I'm reading some options here of, I see, does the whole egg contain vitamin A? And that's a great question. The yolk of the egg is what is where the vitamin A is sitting. Usually the white is where we grab the protein, and the yolk is what's chock full of some of those vitamins and minerals. So that's a great question. All right, I also see a question regarding nuts seem to be a recurring food that is mentioned. What is a serving of nuts? They often have it listed in ounces and I do not have a food scale. Okay, so this is a great question. For nuts, and I'm gonna use almonds, okay? I'm gonna use almonds for reference. 23 almonds is what's considered one serving, and that's about a fourth of a cup. So 23 almonds, is a good serving, is one serving of nuts, and that's how I actually measure it myself. I hope that kind of gives some starting assistance there. Alrighty. Okay, and so I see another question here about what do you think about eggs versus egg whites? I feel like the egg is personally, I feel the egg is best consumed whole, only because you are missing out on one or the other if you don't eat it whole. If you eat the white, you're going to miss out on all the benefit of the yolk. If you miss out on the yolk, if you have the yolk, you miss out on all the protein from the white. So I would say try and consume it whole. You don't have to consume it whole the whole time. If you say, I know some people have concerns about cholesterol and the yolk, so you can consume eggs in a variety of ways. Maybe start with one day with whites, one day with a whole egg. That's up to you, but to get the whole maximum benefit of an egg would be to consume it whole. Alrighty, so I see another question coming through. During this time, I'm trying to limit my trips to the grocery store. Because of this, I don't have a lot of fresh fruit and veggie options at home. Are frozen and canned fruits and veggies still a healthy option? That's an awesome question, and absolutely. So obviously fresh foods are where usually considered ideal, but definitely don't discount canned or frozen vegetables. Actually, in most cases, frozen vegetables are considered healthier, and I'll tell you why. This is because frozen vegetables, fruits and vegetables, are flash frozen on site. That means that those nutrients are actually locked in right on site and are protected from degradation, maybe through transportation or whilst being, you know, by storage, being placed in the grocery store for a long period of time. So the flash freezing protects from all those different circumstances that cause fruits and vegetables to degrade over time. So I would say I have my freezer stocked up with frozen vegetables, not just for our current circumstances, but they're so easy to just grab and make. They don't spoil, obviously, and a little bit better from a nutrition standpoint. Okay, coming back to the chat here for your questions. Suggest a tasty, healthy salad dressing. Absolutely. So when it comes to healthy, so I'll talk about that first. Healthy salad dressing. Well, what makes a salad dressing unhealthy? Usually I think of the creamy ones. There's some extra fat coming from that cream is what makes some of those salad dressings unhealthy. So I like to go more for oil varieties. That would be like your olive oil. Olive oil makes a very great a great salad dressing. Balsamic vinaigrettes are also a great option. It basically strips out a lot of the kind of unhealthy fat, so to speak, and it keeps in olive oil, particularly keeps in some of that high omega-3 value. So healthy fatty acids coming from olive oils. And feel free to play around with your dressings as well. So I mentioned have fun with your salads. You can make your own salad dressings as well. So taking an olive oil and maybe kind of throwing in some herbs in there and mixing the herbs in salad dressing to give it some additional flavor. That's one thing that I feel like we don't make a lot of use of in our households these days is herbs and spices, a really easy way to kind of add a zing of flavor to something. Okay. Well, it looks like that's all the questions that we have so far. And that looks like we've ended a little bit early here. I do encourage you once again to come visit us at askthird@ymcatoledo.org for any questions you may have after the session or anytime. This is available to you guys. And the dietitians at Gem Care Wellness are excited and ready to answer your questions. So please do kind of reach out to us if you have anything. I want to say thank you so much for tuning in today. I really appreciate it. I hope it was a good session. Hope all of you are staying safe and healthy. And take care. Thank you.